Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh and a very good day everyone. So on behalf of University Malaysia Pahang and the UMP STEM Lab, Celeb Digital at UMP STEM Lab Organizing Committee, I am honored to welcome you to today's Celeb Digital Symposium on Media and Information Literacy Across Nation. So I am Nurul Hazina Nordin from University Malaysia Pahang and I will be moderating this session today. So we are very pleased with our collaboration with the UNESCO in organizing this symposium. This symposium is an initiative under Celeb Digital at UMP STEM Lab, which is a collaborative effort between UMP and UNESCO Information for All program. So the symposium aims to raise awareness, discuss and deliberate about digital competencies and its implementation strategies across different nations. So it is a 3-day program targeting school teachers and the education community. And the symposium was held last week on the 3rd and 4th of October. And today we are currently having a physical face-to-face as well as webinar session in University Malaysia Pahang Pekan Campus Malaysia. So before we get started, I'd like to go over a few items so that you know on how to participate in today's program. The webinar today is aired live via UMP STEM Lab YouTube channel as well as PIMPIN Facebook page. Please be patient if there is any technical glitch during this webinar. And if we are disconnected abruptly at any point of time, please hang on tight because we will definitely get back. You will have the opportunity to submit text questions to today's presenter, Prof. Julian, by typing in your questions into the comment section via YouTube or Facebook. You may send in your questions or comments during the presentation. We will collect these questions and address them during question and answer session at the end of today's presentation. If you would like to connect with us to contact us, please email us at stemlab@ump.edu.my. So basically, our program today is under the initiative by UMP STEM Lab. So UMP STEM Lab is established back in 2016. It is a consolidated effort by the staff and students of University Malaysia Pahang, which basically aims to engage with the community. We always bring the tagline of introducing digital making skill set and curriculum. So throughout the years, we have collaborated with various industry partners locally and internationally, as well as agencies from government and non-government organizations. So cumulatively, we have engaged more than 8,000 school children and teachers across the nation. So so today, we are very pleased with our collaboration with UNESCO. And the main objective of this program is to spread the awareness, discuss and deliberate about digital competencies for information literacy. Okay, there are two main events of this collaboration. The first one was held back in March 2022, whereby we have had roundtable sessions with a focus group participants from 24 different countries. And in this symposium, for the past week, we have had talks from representatives from Japan, in which they share about their experience having to deal with media and information literacy, as well as from Thailand, Indonesia, Turkey, and the States. And today, we have this morning a sharing session by the regulatory authority of Malaysia in Malaysia, and after this session, during this session, we will have a sharing session by Prof. Julian. So before I hand this session over to Prof. Julian, I would like to welcome Zian Hong to give welcome notes to the participants today.
Thank you, Nurul, for your excellent introduction remarks. I'm also amazed by the video we have just seen. I've never been to Malaysia, but it's really a warm greeting from UNESCO, a headquarters from Paris. My name is Xian Hong. I'm representing the Information for All program, and it's really great pleasure working with you. First of all, welcome all of you to attend this wonderful symposium. I'm sure it has already produced so much interesting inputs and will be very valuable contribution to entire IFA program. May I ask you to project my PPT and just give you some slides to present our work to see how relevant this symposium to the entire UNESCO's mandate. As you know, that the Information for All program was created in 2001. In the past 20 years, we have committed to the mandate of building inclusive information and knowledge society for all, benefiting everyone without leaving anybody being behind. And the role of IFA by UNESCO mainly serve an international policy platform to trigger discussion, cooperation, and development of policy guidelines, sharing good practices. It's an intergovernmental body. As you know that we are engaging closely with member states on all those actions. To achieve such a huge mandate, IFAP will work on six priority areas, namely information for development, information literacy, information ethics, information preservation, information access, information, and also multilingualism in cyberspace. As you see, information literacy is actually cross-cutting with all the other focus area for building the inclusive society. It's one crucial, essential building block for our mandate. If you remember what has been written in the earliest declaration, Alexandria Proclamation, I really like the quote from there. Information literacy and lifelong learning, they are beacons of this information society. They are really enlightening people, illuminating the human's course to development, prosperity, and freedom in any ages. Particularly nowadays, we have seen that the digital technology is being pervasively used at every society, and there are a huge potential for development, but there are also tremendous challenges. For example, the increasing misuse of information, disinformation, the proliferations of rumors and conspiracy theories, incitement of violence, etc., which request a concerted need and a concerted effort to promote the media information literacy, to make the society, to make young people, to everybody living here, to be more critical, to be sensible, to make sense of using the internet information in this very complicated information environment. In our strategic plan, we are IFAP will really prioritize this information privacy actions to continue to support our member states to integrate the information literacy standards and assessment and into their national education system, into their national strategy. We'll continue to support the member states and all the stakeholders, including our lab and also academia, to collect the data, to measure, to withstand the country, the societies are already or not yet information literate. What should we do more in a certain country to define our interventions? Certainly, capacity building for younger generation, raising awareness among public is another huge area to work with. And that's also, I understand that this symposium is targeted to. Plus, as I think you're all aware that UNESCO is commemorating annually the Global Media Information Literacy Week. For this year, it will take place in the following week, and also with in Nigeria, the global event, but we're encouraging other countries to convene the national initiatives with the theme of nurturing trust. I think that that's also a key point we can think about. I'd like to congratulate on the success of the achievement, Neura, and also all your team in such a wonderful implementation of this project as granted by IFA Bureau last year. We have seen so many wonderful activities and achievements, so much valuable information sharing about lessons learned on enhancing digital competences for information literacy in your country and also in the entire South Asia region. We really look forward to have more outputs from you, and also can be also good practice to be shared among the next platform. And lastly, I'd like to share a recent updated position of UNESCO to handle the complexity of digital transformation. Since now we are discussing a digital competency, because we are living in a much more complex and much more fast evolving digital environment. So UNESCO members has endorsed a official position, a new position in 2015 to promote four major principles applying to the digital environment: human rights, openness, universal access, and also multi-stakeholder participation in the national governance model. And to ensure this major principles to be applied at the country level, we also launched the 303 indicators in 2018. Now we have 45 countries using this ROMIX indicator to measure the entire information ecosystem and to formulate the policy recommendations. I'd like to draw your attention to the category of the indicators on the access in this package. It contains a set of very strong and dedicated indicators to measure the media information literacy and also digital competences, which can be useful for our national policymakers and actors to use to do the empirical and evidence-based research. I also recommend the country Malaysia and other countries in South Asia to consider initiating this assessment, which will eventually enhance the literate digital competency in the country and for all stakeholders. Really, thank you. It's been a really great pleasure to be here. And I'm here with you, and I look forward to hear more discussion. And you can also find more information about the FF on our website. And please feel free to reach out to me with that email address as well. Thank you, and look forward to more discussion with you.
Thank you very much, Zhenhong. Thank you. We're really pleased with this collaboration. Thank you. So, Professor Julian, are you ready?
I am, yes. Thank you for the invitation.
Over to you, Prof.
Thank you. So thank you very much for the invitation to join you. Good afternoon to everybody. I'm going to start to share my slides. And I will make them full screen. So I can't see you now. I can only see my slides. So please tell me if there's any problem, but hopefully you are seeing my window.
Prof, if you can click it on the slide mode show, or have you clicked the slide mode show?
It already is on that mode. I'll try to change it.
Okay. Because currently it's appearing, this screen is showing us the PowerPoint mode. So maybe you can click the button beside it, reading mode, so that the slide is much bigger.
Yeah, that's on that mode for me. Let me change it over, see if I can. It worked earlier in the chat, so let me see. I'm in slideshow mode.
Okay, yes. Okay, if you can switch, instead of slide mode show, can you go to reading mode just beside there? The button just beside the slideshow. On the left button beside the slideshow. Okay. Can you go to the next one? Yeah, that reading mode. Can you click it?
Yeah, I've done that.
Okay. Apparently it is still showing us the same.
Mm-hmm. I think I had the same problem before.
Okay. So if that's the case, can we share via slide?
Yes.
The file is too large. It didn't upload because the file size is too large. Let me try again.
Oh, okay. Okay.
In the technical check, it worked. So let me see why it's not working now. Okay,
so, Okay. So currently, are you sharing? Are you need less to be than 50 megabyte? Okay. If that's the case, if you can just click once more under the reading mode. It was showing clearly just now, yeah, when we do the rehearsal just now.
It looked the same to me, but the guy who was helping me told me it looked okay at your end. How about now?
Okay.
Still.
Okay. It is still showing the same as the one. It is not in this in the presentation mode. So okay. Would it be okay if you email me your slide?
It's too big. I'll have to send it by WeTransfer. You'll have to download. We'll try one more time. I don't know why it worked before and isn't working now. So let's just try one more time.
Oh, okay. So are you having two separate screens now, Prof. Julian?
Just give me a second. I'm going to open the file again.
Okay.
Are you seeing my screen now? No.
I have not. Okay. Yet.
So let me try now.
Okay.
Actually, Nura, I think it's okay. We can proceed with this with a notepad. Mm. We can still see the see the slides clearly.
Mm. Okay. Yeah. Prof. Julian, I think. It is okay if you were to present at this as well because we can still see your slide.
I have some video though, so I have to make sure it will play in the video. But I don't know why it worked before in the technical check and isn't now. So. Let me try one more time.
Okay.
I have, on my screen, I have, are you now seeing all the slides?
Mm.
And now I'm in reading view. So it's reading view on my screen.
Mm.
Okay. So let me just try and choose a different window. Maybe if I share entire screen and then go to the slides. How about now?
Okay, there is no slide appearing yet.
Okay.
If you can go to the just last attempt, yeah. Otherwise, I think it is presentable at this now as well. So if you can go to the slideshow mode beneath there, okay, you can see reading view. If you can click that reading view, just beside it.
Yep. So I've clicked that, and I'm seeing reading view. Okay. It all looks fine to me. So I don't know why it's not coming through on yours.
But now it is working fine, Prof. We can see your presentation in full view. Now it's working.
Oh, okay, good. I don't know now why, but let's go. Okay.
Okay.
Right.
I'll continue. So thank you for this invitation. My presentation is about embedding media literacy in the school curriculum. I'm going to present to you a theory of change, which we call a glocal theory of change, because I'm not an expert in media and information literacy in Malaysia, but we have developed in my research center a theory of change for media literacy in education. And what this does is it moves beyond solutionism to focus on what media literacy can be used for. So I'm going to suggest some ideas about how we embed media literacy in the school curriculum in this way, but I'm not going to advise you on the Malaysian context. I'm going to present you with a global theory which has the potential for local adaptation, hence a global theory of change. Some of the ideas are from this book that I co-authored, The Uses of Media Literacy. And this referred back to an old book by Richard Hoggett from 1957 in the UK called The Uses of Literacy. And Hoggett wrote about what literacy can be used for rather than just what it is. And I think that's a really important thing that sometimes we miss in the media literacy world. We don't think enough about what we want young people to use their media literacy for. We tend to stop at the point where they acquire it or they develop it. So when we ask ourselves this question, we tend to agree that literacy in itself is a good thing. We do not associate harm or danger or risk with literacy. We believe that everybody in the world should be literate, and it's a problem if people are not literate. But when we add media, it becomes more complicated, because we tend to worry about media, we worry about young people's access to digital environments, we worry about the dangers of being in the media world. So when we think about literacy, we see this as innately positive, in itself, a thing we want more of in the world. But when we talk about media literacy, it becomes more complicated, because we want more media literacy, but we want that to be a protective layer for people, something that can help them to become more resilient to the media environment. In other words, we do not associate literacy with danger, but we do associate media literacy with danger. And what I'm going to suggest is that the way to help young people to be more resilient is to make them more agentive with their media literacy, to make them more agents of change through their media literacy. That will improve the media ecosystem and the digital environments in which they operate. So I'm sure that by this point in your symposium, you've already thought about this for a long time, the situation that we find ourselves in. We have a state of information disorder globally, and we have unhealthy media and digital information ecosystems. The state of information disorder consists of five elements: public confusion, cynicism amongst citizens, fragmentation of discourse, and polarization of opinion, irresponsible behavior by politicians, sometimes journalists, information providers, internet service providers, and a state of apathy amongst young people, a feeling that there is nothing that they can do to improve the health of the ecosystem because the situation is loaded too much against them. So we can use these metaphors from environmental thinking, pollution, ecosystem, and this situation is what we refer to as a perfect storm when all these elements combine. So at the bottom of the screen, I've listed the things that are combining in this perfect storm: technology and networks, and austerity in nations, polarization, data surveillance, of course, the economic system of capitalism, the impact of COVID, war in Ukraine, and now, of course, the energy crisis. And because of all of those things combining in such a powerful perfect storm, we do need to be realistic about what we can do about this in schools. Working with young people in schools cannot solve all of these problems through media literacy, but it can offer a small step forward. What's important to remember when we move into this theory of change I'm going to describe is that schools are about the future. They're about equipping young people with the ability to make society better in the future. And you can't organize the future with a playbook from the past. So media and information literacy has to address the future algorithms, data. It can't only be about a way of seeing media and information that's from the past. And that's a real challenge, because teachers, including me, you know, we're not experts in algorithms, data harnessing. We are only experts in critical thinking. So what we need to do with young people in schools for media literacy is give them the media literacy critical thinking skills that they can apply to the future. We cannot be experts in all of the new technological developments that are moving forward. And that's a challenge for teachers, because teachers want to be experts. They want to have the knowledge to give to their students. So for me to say this is about a meeting point between our expertise as critical thinkers and young people's expertise in digital environments, I will refer to this later as a third space. This is a real challenge. So we have two things. We have algorithms and data to think about. And then we have on the left, the quote from Jean Baudrillard about the world we are in now, the era of post-truth, of relative knowledge claims. These are big challenges that we need to help our students to make sense of. So I'm going to now show you a video, which is from the American media literacy scholar, Renee Hobbs. And while you're watching this video, I want you to think, please, about whether you know the answers. Do we know the answers? Can we claim to be experts ourselves in media literacy? Or is media literacy something which is more negotiated and dynamic between teachers and students? Okay, so when I watch that video, I think I know the answers to most of those questions, but in some cases only partially. But they all link together. So the reason why people might prefer certain kinds of TV shows to others, certainly those of us that have access to Netflix, is partly because of personal taste, partly because of algorithms helping to process our tastes in particular directions. So these questions, these 14 questions, all kind of interrelate to each other. But the one I want to draw attention to is the one on trust, because that's the focus of the Media and Information Literacy Week next week, the UNESCO Week. And the question, of course, is not about how do we restore trust, but how do we think differently about what trust is and how people come to trust certain kinds of media and information narratives over others. So I'm in Europe, and I want to just present to you a context from where I'm working. So media literacy education in schools in Europe is fragmented. It's not taught as a discrete mandatory school subject in any EU country. Most member states have not adopted a media education curriculum, so schools are still making choices for themselves. The only country with a designated but optional school subject, media studies, is the UK, and of course, the UK is no longer in the EU. And therefore, initial teacher education in media literacy or media education is restricted, often to the point of total absence. So sometimes people think that the situation in Europe or the US or the West, global North, is healthier. But often when you look into the detail, you find this fragmentation. So really across the world, I think media literacy education is not stable or consistent or significantly resourced. Now, this is a more theoretical way of thinking. For a second, I just want to focus in on this notion of literacy not being something that's static, but it's being something that is dynamic and negotiated and changing all the time, or as in the title of this book, unsettled or unsettling. So if we think about, if we use the vaccine analogy, which of course in our minds at the moment because of COVID, this idea that media literacy can simply inoculate, give people critical antibodies that would protect citizens from misinformation, is complex in what we call the oxymoronic neutrality. In other words, what we have to understand is that people use media literacy for bad things. So media literacy in itself is not a good thing. It has to be combined with a desire to make the world fairer, more just, more positive. So the more agentive uses of media literacy for positive change address the paradox that unhealthy media ecosystems are not caused by a lack of media literacy so much as the toxic uses of them. So when we work with young people in schools, we need to always be thinking about what is media literacy for? What do we want people to do with media literacy? And this makes it different to other school subjects, of course. Although every school subject will have a desire for positive uses of mathematics or physics or language, with media it is more complicated, because the danger otherwise is that we equip our students with media literacy skills which they then use for negative consequences. So how do we do this? How do we move beyond solutionism to work instead with young citizens in local contexts? We talk about something called a third space, and in this third space students can bring their everyday living media literacies into contact with educational critical thinking to unsettle them for positive consequences, but it's complicated, as I will explain. So we have many neutral competence models. You can look online, you can find them everywhere, from UNESCO, European Union, Ofcom in the UK, I'm sure in Malaysia, everywhere in the world there's a model for media literacy or information literacy or MIL. And they tend to include the things on the screen: digital literacy, information literacy, news literacy, visual literacy, and particular ways of thinking about citizenship. And all of these models are good and valuable. But what they don't account for, as I keep saying, is what we want to use these media literacies for. So instead, we need a theory of change for media literacy in schools. What is it for? And it's for four things. Full, safe, and informed access to digital technology and media. And that doesn't only mean access that's available to you in your country or through the technology that you own or through the internet access you have in your home. It's also about the access that you enable or restrict for yourself. If you think about the way we use social media, we tend to restrict our access to the ecosystem by operating in a world where we follow and talk to people that think in the same way as us. The films we watch, the news we consume, the entertainment we consume, we make decisions about access. So access is about being aware of everything that's available to you and trying to have a diverse engagement with media and information. Critical awareness of media representations means we know that media is representing the world to us in particular ways. We know that information cannot always be trusted. We understand persuasion, point of view, agendas from media and information, but we also understand how healthy our media ecosystem is in a broader way, how diverse, how plural, how representative of the whole of society. Once we have these two elements, we then move on to the capability to use our media literacy actively in society. But really importantly, that capability could be used for good or for bad. So the fourth element that we often miss in media literacy is the critical understanding of the consequences of our actions and the uses of our capabilities for positive consequences. And that might be something really significant, like campaigning for change through digital media, or it might be thinking more mindfully about whether you share a Facebook post from somebody that might not be trustworthy. But it's taking action, it's having an understanding of consequences, wanting to be a positive agent of change in the media environment. So the people who are fully media literate can demonstrate all of these things. But the bottom bullet point is really important here. The challenge for schools education is, how do we develop capability with consequences? Because this is about ethics and social justice, not just skills and competences. So it's really hard to teach. It's really hard to manage to achieve this in the school environment. And we need to be aware of that, the challenges in working in this more dynamic, agentive kind of way. Now, this is an old painting from Magritte, the French artist. And it says, this is not a pipe. And I'm going to suggest to you that really, whatever we're talking about, whether we're talking about news, fake news, misinformation, social media, algorithms, television, it's really all about this awareness that this is not a pipe. This is a representation of a pipe. And I always start with this painting with all of my media literacy education work, because once you can understand that you're looking at something that's not the real thing, you're looking at a representation, then you can carry that awareness into all of your engagements with media and digital information. So this is not a pipe is a very important motif for the theory of change we're working with. And think about that now as I show you these two videos. They're both from my country, because I can only really present to you my experience, and then you can relate it to your experience in the context in which you work. I'm going to show you two videos about exactly the same issue, which is people protesting in the UK about climate change and environmental problems. Two videos about the same topic.
This is what happens when direct action prompts a public reaction. Anger erupted after a rush hour train was held up for more than 10 minutes. Neither station staff nor the police intervened.
You couldn't be working your cars.
Imagine someone need to go hospital.
With other Extinction Rebellion members gluing themselves to trains, commuters couldn't understand why public transport had become the latest target.
They're doing it the wrong way. They're doing it for the right reasons, but they're doing it the wrong way.
No one should do that anyway, regardless of what it is. That's just out of order and it's not right. They could have killed themselves anyway.
I think they've really shot themselves in the foot, to be fair. A lot of people getting public transport as opposed to getting their own transport.
You guys are not the target. We're so sorry.
Altogether, three trains were halted by rooftop protests.
People at the station aren't very happy here, you can see.
A cameraman who was streaming live pictures of the protest also became a target as passengers lost patience.
A man in a red jacket was punching in the face a woman who was a commuter, also disrupted. He was calling on him to stop his violence. And that was the most shocking moment of the morning for me.
Altogether, eight people were arrested, among them the Reverend Sue Parfitt, an Anglican priest.
By contrast, this Extinction Rebellion event at Gatwick Airport has been tolerated by both airport officials and the police, because although they're handing out leaflets, they're not disrupting any passengers' journeys.
They said Extinction Rebellion as a whole had voted against halting trains. The group acknowledged it had been divisive.
I'm not condoning the action. XR will not condone that action. But I know what's in their heart and why they were motivated to do it. And I feel a little sorry for them because they got themselves...
I'm sorry for the passengers as well.
Oh, of course I do. As I said, if I was on that train, any of these disruptions, yeah, I would be angry.
But the reality is that if all protests looked like this, they wouldn't get any media attention. As we near the end of a second week of XR demonstrations, only the most disruptive action generates headlines. And that risks alienating the very people they're trying to win over. Ian Woods, Sky News.
They're not doing anything to avert climate catastrophe. And that's why I'm here.
To fight the unbeatable foe, to bear the unbearable sorrow, to run where the brave dare not go, to right the unrightable wrong, to love. To reach the unreachable star, this is my quest, to follow that star, no matter how hopeless, no matter how far, to fight for the right, without question or pause, to be willing to march into hell for a heavenly.
We're not powerless at all. We're very powerful. And in fact, those in power know that we're very powerful. That's why they try to separate us.
Glorious quest that my heart will write peaceful and calm when I'm late.
The International Energy Agency has said fossil fuel investment must stop now.
The world will be better for this. That one man scorned and covered with scars, still strove with his last ounce of courage.
In a world in which we are being driven towards the very edge of the cliff, to love is to resist.
The unreachable star.
So we see two videos about exactly the same issue, protesting about climate change. The first is a conventional news broadcast, which focuses on the disruption that the climate protests have caused. The second is a video produced by Extinction Rebellion, the protesters. And when I use these two videos with students, I say to them, you will have an emotional reaction to one more than the other. You cannot look at these two videos objectively because the biases and the emotional reactions and the feelings you already have about climate change and protest will be triggered by the videos. But if you are media literate, you can understand why the video is creating that response in you, and you can understand that neither are real. Both are representations of reality. Both are representing that reality in different ways. Neither are a pipe. So this is not a pipe. These are not real. These are representations. And what a media literate person can do is take that mindset, that mindful critical thinking about media and information, into any engagement with media and information in the digital environment. And what do we do with that that's more capable, more agentive, so we can read laterally? So the art of reading laterally is about looking into online information and cross-referencing, clicking on links, reading vertically. So this is about fact-checking, opening tabs, thinking about author reliability and target. So my point is that all three examples so far are the same. The Magritte painting, this is not a pipe, it's a representation. The two videos about climate change, they represent the same issues in different ways. And if you read laterally, you will understand that any online source can be compared with other online sources or can be looked into for its efficacy, for its originality, for its reliability. So these are practices of critical awareness that cut across all media and information contexts. Different media, same awareness. So now we're into the third element of our theory of change, where awareness converts into capability when we're more mindful. And at this point, we can start to think about the role of media information as a whole in our lives. What's our media ecosystem like? How is the media ecosystem in Malaysia? How diverse, representative, plural, democratic, how much equity is built into the ecosystem? Doesn't mean we can necessarily change it, but we become more mindful and aware of that. When people read more laterally and misinformation reduces, of course, this starts to improve the health of our media ecosystem. So like a vaccine, where the more people are vaccinated, the lower the risk that a disease can create in a society, the more people who are critically media literate, who read laterally, the less likely they are to spread false information, misinformation, so the ecosystem starts to reduce. So the point I'm making is, it's not only about protecting young people from misinformation, but it's about reducing misinformation itself through having a more media literate citizenry in your society. But we also need a more diverse group of people to produce media in the first place. So when we start to think about media literacy for equity and justice, then we start to think about the consequences being more active. And we want young people to be pushing back against these elements. We want them to be pushing back against media and information which are discriminatory, sexist, racist, or mobilize inequality. We want them to do that in two ways: by their own personal choices about the media and information they engage with and share, but also perhaps the media and information they produce for themselves in a more active, consequential way. So to return to the main motif of my talk, media literacy is not just about fact or fake, but it's about this. But it's also about making new pipes or representing pipes in new ways, being an active, agentive media literate person in the society, in the ecosystem. So now I want to move on to how we can do this. And this is where it gets very complicated. So we talk in our work a lot about third space, and third space is a fairly simple idea. Normally, somebody's first space is their home. It's their community. It's the environment they're in every day, informally, their habitus, their context. And the second space is either school or education for students or the workplace for others, but it's the formal institution that you go to. And you can go to it physically, or now since COVID, like today, we can go to it, in my case, virtually. But you go to a different space, a formal institutional space. And the third space is a space in between. And it can be in between either physically or metaphorically, or it can be digital or virtual. But it's not just about the location. It's about things being exchanged from the first space and the second space. So teachers and students share expertise, and learners bring expertise with them, repertoires of literacy, funds of knowledge. So in this case, it's students who are immersed in digital media. They bring that expertise with them, and they exchange it with our expertise as teachers, as critical thinkers, as people who can be theoretical and academic about media and information. Between us, in the third space, things happen that are productive. This way of thinking about literacies, and this can be all literacies, not just media literacy, but this way of thinking about literacies is to think of them as social, situated, and dynamic. So learners bring with them perhaps their own definitions of media literacy. They are likely to be media literate in specialist domains. They are likely to be able to function effectively in a variety of domains, and sometimes they will be expert and sometimes they will not be expert. They might be video game players who are highly expert in how video games work. but they may not be expert in how news media work, for example. On the right-hand side, us, the teachers. And again, we are also sometimes expert and sometimes not. So when I showed you the Renee Hobbs video and the 14 questions, probably some of those questions you could answer and some of those questions you couldn't answer, or some would be partial. Teachers themselves must be researchers of media literacy practices, not seeing media literacy as a fixed, static thing, but a thing that's always changing. And we must acknowledge the expertise of our students, which is challenging, and our own inexpertise at times. This will help us support the learning of new media literacy practices for learners themselves as reflective practitioners. So I really think this kind of education is very different to others, because we're working with our students in this third space, which makes it more complex and challenging. But if we don't do it, I think it's doomed to failure, because the idea of older teachers teaching media literacy to younger people who are immersed in digital media all the time is a false economy. It's an impossible dynamic, I believe. My PhD student, Monsak Chevrik from Thailand, produced this very nice visual, in my opinion. He was interested in aligning notions of Buddhist mindfulness in Thailand with media and information literacy from a kind of UNESCO global context. And he developed this model of thinking about media literacy as a mindset, as a form of mindfulness. And this is much more than just fact-checking, and it's much more closer to the educational influence of Freire, where people develop and use media literacy competences according to their environments, needs, and available resources. So everything I'm saying to you this afternoon is from the UK, from Europe, and also probably from a broadly global North perspective, Western perspective. The idea of the theory of change is that it's adaptable to local environments, needs, and resources, which is why I don't claim to be an expert on media literacy in Malaysia, but I hope to offer a model which can be adapted for media literacy in Malaysia. So when we embed this more dynamic notion of media literacy in schools, we have both challenges and opportunities. So dynamic literacies, can we work with young people in this way? Can we have a framework which is more dynamic, less static? Can we facilitate third spaces? Does our educational system and our school environment allow these third spaces to be designed? And can we think about new forms of literacy practice, such as curation, when people curate their lives through social media? I this morning have already sent two tweets about this talk. I'm curating my work, my existence, to the kind of Twitter community, I suppose. And that's a literacy practice, how people do that, which we have to include in our work if we're going to take it seriously. So can we do these things? Well, our research says that the challenge is to adapt educational practices to free agentive, social, and connected learners from static systems. If we have a notion of media literacy, which is that you either have it or you don't, or you have a level of it, a lower level or a higher level, and then we teach it and then we measure it, we're not going to get into this more dynamic, agentive, positive, social form of media literacy, because it's too static. And the problem then is that a static curriculum actually puts more young people at risk from these things: propaganda, hate speech, disinformation, fake news, online harms. Agentive people who have media literacy and use it in the world are less vulnerable, because they're making a difference in the ecosystem. So that's really ambitious for this theory of change, but I think it's a really important statement to make. So to conclude, moving towards a conclusion, using the theory of change to embed media literacy. So the classroom, not the school, but the classroom within the school is a potential third space. It can transform things within the second space of the school. So just to be clear, because it's complicated. First space, home. Second space, school. Classroom within the school can be a third space if we have that exchange between students and teachers. In the third space, digital environment can be navigated in new ways with new forms of experience and expertise. To do this, we need school students to bring their lived experience of this digital environment with them, And with the support of teachers in the third space, they move through this theory of change. The classroom becomes the third space in which media literacy converts to capability for young people, with positive consequences in the media and information ecosystem over time. Won't happen while you're teaching them, but if they come out of school with this more positive mindset about their engagement with the media and digital information, that generation of people will transform your media and information ecosystem for the next 10 years. That's the hope. But as I've said, it's globally orientated. We know it works in different contexts because we've used it in the UK, in all the countries where BBC Media Action work. We worked with them in 20 countries using this theory of change. In Tunisia recently, in a project between Turkey and Bangladesh with refugees from Syria, Myanmar. And in Ghana, we're working with the British Council. But in every application of this media literacy theory of change is differently configured. And that's important because the approach views media literacy as deeply situated in cultural and geopolitical contexts. And that's also important because it attempts to avoid more universal and potentially colonial assumptions, which are endemic to the solutionism. So all the models I began with at the start, the digital media literacy competence models, are good, positive, well-intentioned, but they risk an unintentional colonial framing if they are not malleable and agile enough to be adapted to local contexts in diverse societies. Thanks for listening. But of course, my presentation is also not a pipe. It's my presentation to you, my representation of the reality of media and information literacy and how we might embed it in schools. That concludes my presentation. I hope you found it interesting, and I will stop sharing my screen.
Thank you very much, Prof. Julian. That is very interesting and refreshing. This is not a pipe, yeah? This is a representative of a pipe. Okay, so we have a few questions here. Is it okay for you to take up a few questions here, Prof?
Of course, yes.
All right. So I have one question from Fatin Amira. So Fatin Amira is one of the audience. If you can see currently now, one of the screen is showing the classroom that we are having here in Malaysia. So Fatin asks, lack of awareness can lead to misinformation. How can we comprehend, how to comprehend any media actual implied information critically, not literally, which sometimes lead to misinformation as well?
Sure. So thank you for the question. So I've talked at a macro broad level. Of course, to develop that awareness in students, you need to go through step by step deconstruction of media and information. So examples would be who is representing what, why, and for what purpose? What kind of language is being used? What kind of visual imagery is being used that is persuasive? So, of course, to get to awareness, critical awareness, you need to teach the skills of critical reading, which takes a lot of time and needs to cut across every media. So, for example, I sometimes use like the two videos I showed today. I sometimes use Eisenstein's Battleship Potemkin from very, very long time ago, because it's the first example of montage editing where you see the soldiers on the Odessa steps in, of course, it's very, very topical now, but at the time, you know, this director is trying to persuade the population of the importance of a political moment. So you see soldiers' feet marching and a pram falling down steps. You see, you know, the brutal soldiers and the innocent public. And now when we see this, it's not anything interesting because we see the juxtaposition of images all day, every day, constantly. Social media, television, news, advertising, all day. But actually, it has only been the last 100 years of human civilization where media and technology have had this power. So you have to take your students through the theoretical and analytical skills to understand how media and information is representing the world in a particular way to get to the place I'm talking about now. And that's difficult for all of us. But I think that the best way of doing it, as I said about Third Space, is to be honest about our own bias. And this is a difficult thing to acknowledge, but bias is kind of part of being human. So we need to move away from fake or fact, true or false, to how do we come to trust some things and not others? And how can we be reflective about how we're doing that, and be honest about that ourselves? I did a big piece of research in the UK about Brexit and the way in which the Brexit campaign, let's just say, certain things were said that may not have been accurate. And what you find is that people know that things aren't true, but if they like the things that aren't true, they can go with it. So critical media and information literacy is about actually facing up to that. And in whatever context you're working, just saying, like, how is this text, this media and information text, how is it persuading me? And how might I still be persuaded, but understand how I'm being persuaded? That's the critical mindset.
Okay, thank you. So I have this second question from Fazila Noijem. She asked here, your opinion on how early can we introduce media literacy to school children? As you mentioned just now, literacy is keep evolving. How early should we introduce? At what age do you recommend this sort of like awareness about this media to young children?
So obviously every country has a different educational system and different attitudes towards what can be covered in the classroom. So of course I can only advise from a perspective from where I am. Here in the UK we can do this with primary school children, and the obvious way of starting is to look at advertising, because primary school children will see advertising all the time every day, and this can be quite an innocent starting point, like, you know, the presents you want for Christmas, why do you want those presents, where's that coming from, what's persuading you? And that can be fun, and it's not kind of, you know, hugely serious and scary for children, and it's not going to upset parents too much as well. And then of course once children start to have smartphones, then you need to introduce kind of online safety. So I think it's graded, and it's depending on the country and the environment. In the UK we have the problem because there's a huge amount of interest in media literacy, but children are not allowed to have phones in school. And so there's an obvious problem, because how do you teach about the thing you want somebody to use safely without using the thing, right? It's like trying to learn to drive a car without a car, right? So you have to be mindful of how school managers, educational ministries, and parents need to understand what's happening. And you need to take those people with you. But with that said, the earlier you can possibly start this process of just thinking about, how am I reacting to this image? Why do I like this? Why does this interest me? Why does this entertain me? It's not just a neutral thing. It's about a process of, again, representation. The earlier you can start to do that, the better.
May I add one point?
Yes. Yes, please, Daniel.
I like this question because I'm also pondering about it. You know, since the COVID, we all perceive the trend that the children around the world started to use the tablet, use the mobile phone much earlier than before. In the confinement during the pandemic in many countries, and the kindergarten, primary school, they start to e-learning, I hope to say. And they need to contact their friends really from so early age. Really, I think it's a kind of, they are born digital. I mean, the new generation, they are born with a phone. And even some parents, they are showing, they're using phone and the computer, iPad to entertain their children since they were babies. So I think that, yes, really the earliest the better. And also I think the parents also need to have this kind of media information literacy education to avoid to use the devices sensibly when we to avoid the addiction from the children from too early age, because I'm still doubting that it can be a part of impact to the brain development when the children were really too small. They couldn't control themselves. They can easily attracted by the social media. So I think that's as a very serious issue, not only to adopt the early education to the children, but also train the parents' school and also have a great framework to maybe some regulations as well from which age you can allow for the school to have the tablet in the school for education. Certainly more research on that. So that's my 2 points. But maybe I can add up one more question, maybe also to Professor. Thank you for your wonderful presentation. I have also a question about, do you think that in the media information literacy education, I also see we have so many girl students in the room from the symposium. Do you think we should also have a more gender sensitive approach to design some module for our young girls and young women, since I assume they are really under quite different risks and threats in using the digital technologies. Thank you.
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, the answer is only yes. I mean, it's in some of the work we did with BBC Media Action, particularly a project in India, which was about digital literacies of girls, you know, who were being excluded from kind of civic life through various, for various reasons, but access to digital technology was a big part of that. Then yes, there's an educational program which is specifically gendered. And I think that, as I said, with this kind of global model, you would, when you look at what you want the positive consequences to be, you might have a situation in a particular country or region where that's what the consequences need to be. The ecosystem change needs to be gendered. So yeah, I absolutely agree. Of course, the challenges with that are you're reacting to the problem. And going back to your earlier point, I mean, I actually think it's really difficult to do this, but with anything else, you kind of try to prepare people in school before they encounter something in the outside world, right? That's what school is for. So what you would really do in an ideal world is you would introduce smartphones to children or tablets to children in the school environment before they start to access them in the outside world. We do it in education around media and information. We do everything the opposite way. We wait until the problem is there, and then we try and use education to resolve the problem, and it's too difficult. And again, I think the same is true with, gendered relations to media and digital technology as well, that we are trying to address a societal problem which we've allowed to become prominent. Now, if you were able to educate younger people about media ecosystems, the idea also is that their expectation of the media environment changes. They want more from it. They can then start to think about representation of women, the number of women that are visible in media, or the same is true with all demographics. You know, you start to think about who do you see on screen, who are journalists, who are the people for, you know, you do that. If you do that early, then you're more likely to have a generation of young women who expect more from media, whereas what we tend to do is allow the problem to become hugely significant and then try and use education to address it. So the short answer is absolutely yes. Gendered programs where they're needed is important. But I think there's also that more complex, when do you do things with media information and how do you respond to the societal context?
Okay, thank you, Prof. So as you and Zenho mentioned just now, as early as possible, and would address this different gender as well. So I have this one question from Ash or Saidatul. So Saidatul is one of the speakers, and she spoke in the symposium this morning. Saidatul asked, how does media literacy address skepticism? Hardcore skeptics are themselves critical of any information they encounter. In a way, they too are media and information literacy practitioners. So your comments on that?
Yeah, it's a brilliant question. It's the most important question, right? Like, do you have a situation where we all become so media and information literate, so critical, so skeptical, that it becomes a kind of postmodern relativist nightmare where nobody believes anything? But I would say that's healthy. Let me get to the end of this, because it will sound strange at the start, but better to have a situation where nobody believes anything is real than a situation where everybody believes everything is real. The balance is in the middle, right? So, you know, I can live my life as a, you know, I'm professor of media and information. I can live my life not really trusting anything, but I don't believe I'm in a kind of relativist skeptical nightmare, because I can find my way and navigate my way around the things that I believe are more socially just, are more positive for a diverse society, are more politically, you know, hygienic in the way I see that. And I would rather have that kind of hyper skepticism than, you know, blind faith and trust in everything. But I think it's a challenge, right? And you have to find your way kind of in the two. There's a phrase, isn't there? Nothing is true, so everything is possible. And one of the problems with this, the implication of what I'm describing, is you arrive at a kind of post-truth nightmare where we don't believe anything, and you can have alternative facts. But, you know, there are objectively more trustworthy information sources than others. And that's part of the process of this theory of change, is we, in the awareness stage, the lateral reading stage, is about saying, well, actually, we're not just living in a world where we're comparing truth claims to each other. There is truth, right? There is, things have happened and can be reported accurately or not. And, you know, you can spot the difference between a deep fake video and a video which was made faithfully. However, you have to hold on to the fact that neither are real. One is closer to reality than the other, but both are trying to persuade you and represent the world in different ways. So, you know, it's there's no ideal happy medium, but I think the state of healthy skepticism. Sorry, somebody's calling me in Teams. The state of healthy skepticism is healthier than the state of ignorant trust. But it's complicated. It's a great question. Thank you for asking that question.
Okay, I have this one last question from Farizan Zakaria. She asked about the role of teachers in building and enhancing dynamic literacy. What's your point? Or what? How do you take this?
Yeah, great question again. Yeah, so I think it's two things. One, it's a leap of faith. It's a change in the mindset to talk to the, okay, we're not the experts on everything here. We're going to work with students to do this thing between us, right? And I know that's really hard, because if you're a teacher, you've been trained and your whole professional identity is, I have the knowledge, I'm going to help give it to my students. And now we're saying, they have knowledge, we have knowledge, together we're going to work in this third space. So firstly, the role of teachers is to try to relax about expertise and see it as a co-creation between students and teachers. And then secondly, it's about designing a learning environment which can be a third space. So you've always got to think about, well, we're not just going to exchange expertise for no reason. We want an outcome. And that outcome has to be educational. Our students need to pass exams. They need qualifications. They need skills for work, university. You know, it can't just be for reasons of, you know, social justice. But how can we design a space where these things can be exchanged and students can learn and qualify and be more dynamic in the future? And that's really complicated and hard to do, but you've always got to be thinking about think about your learning environment as a space you design where these things come together. What am I bringing to it? What are they bringing to it? How is it combining? What is it leading to? So mindset shift and then learning design are the two things that teachers can do.
Okay, that wraps up our session for today. So I would like to, on behalf of University of Malaysia Pahang, I would like to thank again Prof. Julian McDougall for a very nice and refreshing thoughts, and having to come to us this second time because of the first time lagging and so on. And thank you, Zian Hong, for your welcome notes just now. And we are really pleased with this collaboration, and also the teachers who are in campus today. Thank you very much. And we look forward to see you sometime soon. And hope to see you guys again. Okay, thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.